All right, so it's quiet now. It's not the weekend. It's a weeknight because we've been crazy, crazy busy. Been working 7 days a week, and it's time for questions 62. Here's the first one. This is by Vangelis N. I wonder if he knows John. What is a so-called engine flameout? Obviously, there's loss of ignition and power, but what can exactly be the cause? And what's the procedure for restarting it in case of a flight, for example, at a certain altitude? Well, every flight occurs at a certain altitude. Yes, it does. Okay, a flameout is when the flame is extinguished and there's still fuel. Usually there's still fuel being sprayed by the fuel nozzles, but there's no flame. It's hard to do. It's an extremely rare event. I should mention that this is our test cell. We have flameouts all the time. We have flameouts almost every test because we have full manual control of everything. We even have a computer that can adjust the scheduling of the variable stator vanes independent of what the engine wants it to do. That's an absolute no-no. There's no other engine that can do that besides research engines. All the fighter jets, all the airliners, those VSVs are essentially hardwired. They are hardwired. There is no software controlling them. They are actually they're dependent on certain variables of the engine, and they cannot be in the wrong spot unless you adjust the actual physical threaded rod that connects the hydraulic actuator to the arm. You can adjust that, but there's no software glitch that'll make it go nuts and do the wrong thing. We can do that here. So, we have flameouts all the time because we can go right past either side, either end of the operating spectrum of fuel, RPM, and all that kind of stuff. So, that's what a test cell's for. We test things. Once it's been signed off and packaged and sent to the user, it's going to operate within its normal parameters and it's not going to flame out, with extremely rare exceptions. As a matter of fact, in 10 years of working here with the industrial LM1500s in applications all around the world and other engines, I know of zero flameouts in service. So that's how rare they are. Airliners are more likely to have a flameout if they run out of gas. And that's pretty rare, although it does happen every decade or so. It does happen, but it's extremely rare. I guess that's the nature of these questions. We like to focus on the rare and the unusual. So that's what a flameout is. What can cause it? Let me get back to the question. Sorry about that. What exactly can cause it? Okay, you can have, usually there's a loss of fuel to the engine, or a momentary throttle back below the idle position and it basically shuts off. It's really hard to do that with a modern aircraft. Older ones, it's easy. But for example, I was in a Sabre jet a couple weeks ago, the F-86 Sabre or the Canadair Sabre 6. There's a throttle quadrant like this, and there's a hard stop. You bang the throttle against it. That's idle. You would probably have to kick it with your foot. You'd have to stand on the cockpit and kick on the throttle lever to break that little barrier. It's like a gate shifter in a Ferrari. It's like the shifter gate. How do you move the shifter to the wrong spot with that gate there? Anyway, the throttle has to be moved outboard and back and in to shut the engine off. You can't just slam it back and shut the engine off. And I'm sure that all more modern aircraft are more sophisticated than that. It's very difficult for the pilot to intentionally flame out the engine. So, what else? Massive disturbance to the air inlet of the engine. Now, with turbofan engines, that is very unlikely. With the older turbojets, it's more likely, still difficult. The scene in the movie Top Gun is a fictional scene made up by a director to carry a dramatic point in the story across with a slight reference to reality. Can you see how big that reference is? It's that big. I can't even see it. That's how much reality is in Top Gun. So give me a break. Please stop asking me about Top Gun because it's all hooey. So And how do you restart it? Well, what you do is you need to have the engine above starting speed. And so if it's just flamed out, you're doing good. But the engine will wind down. Even as the aircraft is coasting ahead, the engine will wind down. And you will get to the point where the RPMs are insufficient to start the engine. So before it winds down to nothing, you need to flip on the igniters and give it a bit of fuel. And everything should be fine. You've seen Robin do that here. He's our number one operator because he's the most fearless and he has the most experience. He's shut engines off and relit them on the fly many times. You just have to remember, in all the stress, you've got to remember to flip on the igniters, because if you just give it fuel, you just spray a whole fog of fuel out the back. So then you hit the igniters and away it goes. It's great. In the Sabre jet, there's a button on the upper left-hand side, and I forget what it's called, but it's like emergency auto ignition or emergency relight or something like that. And what you can do is you can push that button and the igniters will continue to go. So if the pilot has some kind of instability or problem, or if he's tumbling through the air, he can hit that button and even if there's a momentary flame out, it'll immediately re-catch. So I'm sure there's those kind of buttons in many planes. I've heard about one in the 747 called in-flight restart. That'd be the same kind of thing. That's all I know about flame outs and in-flight ignition, because I work with engines. I don't work with planes. Anyway, next question. This one's by Esquihill. And it's in private comments. So here's an example of me answering a question now, weeks later, as opposed to answering him directly in comments, because private comments on my channel are only seen by whoever puts the comment in and me. It's like email. So don't put your questions in there, please, because they will just be lost like a piece of lint in the dryer of life, unless it's a really good question, and then I'll maybe put in a video. So this one must be pretty good. Let's see. Esquihill says, don't most commercial jet engines have thrust reversers? Okay, I think so, I guess. Most commercial jet engines. Sure. I can't find any thrust reversers in your videos. How would you test an engine with one? I've read some accident reports where thrust reversers were involved. Uncommanded deployment, only one deploying, etc. That's a lot of stuff that I don't get into because the thrust reverser, is it part of the engine or is it part of the airplane? I've always thought about it as part of the airplane. It might be part of the engine, but certainly not the engines we deal with. We deal with industrial versions of military turbojets and military turbojets, none of which have thrust reversers. Airliner engines can be, the design, not the actual engine, but the design of the engine can be converted to an industrial power unit. One of the parts of the conversion is deletion of the thrust reversers, because as we've covered many times before, industrial engines don't create thrust. They create a high pressure, high velocity stream of gas to be fed into a power turbine, to spin that power turbine to make torque on a shaft to do work, whether it's propelling a ship, generating electricity, or pumping gas. There you go. Okay, there's lots of accident reports, very interesting, about thrust reversers malfunctioning. That's not an area that I work with, so I wouldn't know. All I can say is I've read some of those reports and they're very interesting. So seek out and ye shall find. Before we get to the third question, a little bit of bonus here. A lot of people ask why the engine doesn't take off, doesn't just zoom away if it's making all that thrust. It's making close to 10 tons of thrust. Well, this one's not. This is an industrial version of a J-79, but the J-79 makes about 10 tons of thrust. Why doesn't it just take off? This is quarter inch thick, 6x6 steel tubing, square tubing, framework. See that link there? That's 1 inch thick steel holding the engine to the frame. This is only the front, we call it the front hoop. It doesn't carry any thrust loads, it just holds weight. But if you were to push on this thing with 5 or 10 tons, it wouldn't move. It's very, very strong. And the triangulated braces back there, those can withstand thrust. You could probably pull on that with the force of, okay, I'm gonna bet two locomotives. They'd be spinning their wheels on the tracks before that thing would ever move. I'm going to bet that. I'll bet you. I'll bet you a six-pack. You bring the trains, you bring the tracks, we'll hook that up, we'll pull on them. All right? Engine's not going anywhere. All right. Now, this is an interesting question by Cramp Drucker. I like that name, Cramp Drucker. He is questioning our practices in the shop, which brings me to a subject I've always wanted to talk about. And he says, I'm concerned about the surface of clean parts. Scratches can become the genesis of fatigue cracks, at least according to my instructors. We have very eloquent instructors. Now, this is all true, except there's no need to be concerned because of people that work here, they think. And there's an area of thinking that I have called to myself, never in public before, to be cleaning theory. Cleaning theory. What's the theory of cleaning or scraping or brushing? The theory behind it. Well, in a nutshell, you can use nutshells too. There's a dirt or a deposit. There's the part or the substrate, and there's the material or the chemical or the tool you're going to use to remove, to separate the dirt from the substrate. In a perfect world, the substrate is impervious to chemicals. It's rock hard and it's strong as steel. It might be steel. And the deposit or the dirt is softer than the steel and soluble in some kind of chemical. So if it's mud, use water and it washes away. If it's grease, you can use solvents and wipe it away. And if it's a crusty deposit that is softer than the steel, you need to find a tool, a cleaning tool, that is harder than the contamination and softer than the substrate. Then you can scrub away like crazy. You're never going to damage the part and you're going to destroy the contamination and it's going to be beautiful and everything's great. Things become problematic when the substrate is the same hardness as the contamination, or the substrate is softer than the contamination, which can be the case with mild steel and rust. Rust particles are harder than steel that makes an abrasive paste. So you can chemically remove it, or you can very carefully remove it with a tool that is hopefully still softer than the steel, but can dislodge the rust, because rust, although it's made of hard particles, it fails when you push on it. It's like a cracker or a piece of bread. It crumbles. The pieces it crumbles into are very hard and can scratch steel, but you can dislodge it and remove it, hopefully without damaging too much of the steel. Then in that horrible case where you've got something that you've had to remove and you have indeed scratched the part. Okay. The scratches do become the genesis of fatigue cracks or cracking of any kind. So then what you have to do is you have to find a way to get rid of the cracks. So that means using ever finer types of abrasive until you can polish out the crack. That, in a sense, is what you do with blending of the blades, which I have dealt with in a video called The Leading Edge, which I invite you to watch right now. Now. Okay? We try to follow proper cleaning theory, now that I've made it up. I haven't made it up. It's something that people who have been working on removing corrosion and deposits and contamination forever, have been thinking about this. It's best when your contamination is softer than your tool, and your tool is softer than your substrate, then you can go nuts, and everything's great. Okay. Excellent. The fourth question is an important one, because we're about to retire a subject. Right now, right here, as we discussed in a previous video in the Q series. I think it was 60 or 61. Okay, this is from Trevor Greenan, Rovert in brackets, or parentheses. I'm curious about the difference between a directly connected power shaft and a power turbine. I'm assuming that a direct mechanical shaft would be more efficient because it can have the same RPM as the engine. Well, you're thinking piston engines. But would it make it harder on to start the engine? Well, that's actually true. But using a power turbine, the exhaust gases already have much of their energy stripped from them. Which type is more efficient? The last part of your question is meaningless. Which type is more efficient? Efficiency is simply a ratio of what to what? Smarties per pound, gerbils per mile, smiles per flight of stairs, giggles per gallon. That's efficiency. Whatever you want to define, efficiency is a ratio of something to something. Usually it's miles per gallon, or passenger seat miles per ton of fuel, or specific fuel consumption of an aircraft engine is pounds of thrust divided by pounds of fuel consumption per hour. Yes, that's what it is. Okay, so efficiency of a gas turbine engine used in an industrial situation is determined by the power turbine and how hard it's pushed. If you're running your LM1500 at 25% power, which would be about 70% RPM, we've talked about that as well. RPM equals, power is a function of RPM. They're not linearly related. So you're running at 70% RPM, 25% power, you are incredibly inefficient. Incredibly inefficient. These things are only efficient between 95 and 100% RPM and power. So up there, 95 to 100, that power is kind of, it is almost linear there. But at the bottom power settings, these are horribly inefficient. They burn a lot of gas and they don't do a whole lot. That's why we don't use gas turbines in cars and trucks. That's the main reason. Fuel consumption does not go down with RPM like it does with a diesel engine or a car engine or a piston engine or a gasoline engine as well in these. Okay, so we're getting to another part of the question here. Phone's gone black. I'm assuming that a direct mechanical shaft would be more efficient because it can have the same RPM. Well, that's true, only if the direct mechanical shaft is designed, it's in an engine designed for it, because it's not a direct mechanical shaft. With the 501, there's only one turbine. It's got four stages, but it's one turbine. It runs the compressor and the output shaft. So it is a compressor turbine and a power turbine at the same time. With this engine, the LM1500, it has a compressor turbine, and it takes enough power to drive the compressor and leaves all the rest of the energy in the exhaust gases to drive a power turbine. The advantage of that is you're not starting the load when you're starting the engine. But there is no such thing as a direct mechanical connection, power connection. It's all run by the turbine. Anyway, we're stopping that now. We're retiring this subject because it's dealt with in a video I made recently, a little while ago, called Power Turbines. There's actually a couple of videos in a series called Power Turbines. So please watch those. I explain it much better than I did here. Very good then. Okay, now the segment that we've all been waiting for. We're gonna pick a square, any square. Pick a square. Hang on. All right, we're in front of the LM1500 industrial gas generator, which is basically the same as a J79 fighter jet engine, just minus a lot of the aircraft stuff, which is gonna make this easier for me to do and easier for you to get through because there's a lot of stuff not here. But the front frame's in the way, the front frame of the test cell. This is known as the front frame or the air inlet and front bearing housing. We call it the front frame because it's just simpler to say. This one is made of alloy or casting. There's two types. One's aluminum alloy casting, one is a fabricated steel. They're both great. This one is aluminum alloy. Right there, can you see that? You can see that right there. This is where the data plate is on most engines. Upper left hand front, there's a data plate. It describes what the engine is. Let's see. It says General Electric gas generator section, assembly identity number, serial number for turboshaft power unit, GE model, Cincinnati, Ohio. Okay, cool. It'll tell you what it is. If you're ever gonna go buy a jet engine to fire up in your backyard or to build or whatever, you need to know what it is. This is a GB 101. There's also a GB102, but for example, if it was a J79, there's a -1, -3, -5, -8, -10, -11, -11, -15, -17, and -19. Very mysterious and much sought after -17. Ooh, I didn't say that. Anyway, they're all different, and you need to know which one you got. Okay, this thing here is a shipping mount. It's not used in the aircraft at all. Where is an aircraft mount? At the top there, they use those. And the rear aircraft mounts are out of frame, but if you look at my video called Phantom Engines in Texas, we talk about the engine mounts. Okay, this is a ring here that connects to these little arms. And those arms are connected to the VSVs. Actually, this is the first ring of airfoils is ahead of the compressor blades. So this is inlet guide vanes. And they turn with these little arms, actuated by this ring, which is pushed on by this L-shaped bell crank, which is the pivots right here, and it goes like this. And this is pushed on by this rod. And this rod is actually, it pushes on all the other rings, but you see this one bell crank is different. It's got a big arm, connects to the hydraulic cylinder. So when the cylinder pulls back, it moves all these arms. And you've seen this in several of my videos when I try to show the VSVs working when the engine throttles up. Okay. These are the lines, not this one. This is one of the lines going to the cylinder that operates the VSV linkage. They're all coordinated. Each of these have a different geometry. And each of them are adjustable, and they're all lock wired because once they're adjusted, they stay in sync, and you don't want to mess with it. This is a gearbox vent line. It's a rigid line, comes up to here, and it's actually terminated with a screen. So that's how you can tell it's a vent. It basically allows the chamber inside the gearbox to equalize at somewhere near atmospheric pressure. It's vented to the atmosphere. This is probably a drain line. Is it a drain? No, this would be the retraction line. This would be the extension line. When the engine is started, the ram is extended, and when the engine speeds up, the ram pulls in, and it moves this way. And this thing is basically done. It's finished its movement by what we would call flight idle in a flight engine, so around 85% RPM, 84-85%. Ground idle is around 60%, 59 or 60. And between ground idle and flight idle, it changes. So we discussed variable geometry in the past few videos. I like that better. It's spread out over several videos, so you got to watch them. There is no just compressor stall video. Okay, so whether you like it or not, you have to learn a few things. It's awful. I know it's awful, but you know, try to live with it. Okay, this is an electrical connector that we're using. This is an aircraft part. We're using a speed pickup over there that pops into an aircraft connector. This is unique to this user. Not all industrial engines have this. It's just a way of measuring the speed of the engine. This is the main gearbox. Right here is where a generator runs for making electricity. An alternator makes electricity for the afterburner ignition, not used in the industrial engine. Here is where the main electrical generator would be if it was in an aircraft. And it's a great big heavy thing. It's several hundred pounds. It's not there. Very nice. What else? This is the controller for the VSVs. There's electronic controls, and there's hydromechanical. This one's hydromechanical. This thing here is the feedback cable. It's like a bicycle shifter cable. It goes to this pump thing here that helps to decide how much oil goes to the VSVs. It's also complicated. I don't work on this system. And what else have we got? Basically all the actuating rings. This section of the compressor to here, right to there, there's a split line here. mainly because I think there's different alloys of steel, but the compressor goes all the way back to here. I'm out of the picture now, hang on. There we go. The compressor goes right back to here, 17 stages, and I think 7 or 8 or 9, something like that, 8 or 9 are right here. So this is called the low pressure cases and the high pressure cases, but not to be too confusing, it's one single compressor turning at the same speed. This is the low pressure end of it, this is the high pressure end of it, but it is a compressor. It's not a low pressure compressor and a high pressure compressor. That is a term, those are terms used in a two shaft engine with the two compressor sections turning at different speeds because they're on different shafts. This is all one shaft. We call this the high pressure end and the low pressure end. These are two bleed air ports that are blocked off because they're not used in this particular engine. But on the other side, they are used to cool bearing sumps. This is the mount for the cylinder. It's a smaller diameter piston inside there than in the aircraft because this uses a hydraulic system at 1600 PSI. I'm making that up. I think it's 1600. It's more than 1000. In the aircraft, it's a larger piston because it uses fuel pressure at 400. And so to get the same force on the VSVs, smaller piston, higher pressure, bigger piston, lower pressure. The reason it doesn't use liquid fuel like the aircraft engine is because this engine runs on natural gas or propane. So we're gonna go that way just a bit and I'll show you what I mean. All right, we've got yellow tape covering the outlets of some of the air outlets of the midframe. There's an excellent diagram on the internet, the interweb net, about this particular piece. It's very complicated. If you look up J79 airflow diagram, you'll get an awesome multicolored diagram lengthwise and crosswise through this part here, showing the passages of various pressures and temperatures of air and what they're used for. It's awesome. If you're interested in this engine, you will have more detail than you know what to do with. So go look for J79 airflow diagram. I don't own it, I didn't make it, but it's awesome. These are the flex lines to the fuel nozzles. We're getting bigger, we're getting a big giant rectangle here, but what the heck, right? These are the fuel nozzles are here. This is the main fuel manifold. It's a massive reservoir of pressurized gas. And the fuel on the far end and the fuel on the close end from here, it's all the same. There is no gradient. Because the pressure is so high in here and the delivery nozzles are so small, it all works out. The engineers did a good job. Okay, from a special Monday night edition of Your Questions Answered, number 62, thanks for watching.
Well, how come nobody asked about the hat? Here's a bonus, a special bonus. It's only about a month away, but the World Jet Boat Racing Marathon is gonna be in Fort St. John and Taylor, BC, and the surrounding area, and the Kiwis are coming. The fast New Zealanders are coming. They're coming to race against us on our own rivers. It's going to be great. So make sure you show up. Did I mention that the admission to watch the races is free? World Championship Jet Boat Racing Marathon. It's free to watch. Come on down.